Welcome to the program. This week we have a diverse range of views around the table and plenty of contentious issues to discuss, from getting the unemployed working again to the need for a carbon tax. What's our attitudes towards women in the military? And also we'll be discussing the Greens. Are they a party of extremists or are they a mainstream party, as Bob Brown suggests? Joining us this week, the Human Services Minister, Tanya Plibersek, Greens Senator-elect Lee Rhiannon, the former Liberal leader, John Hewson, and the Liberals' Senate leader and the Shadow Minister for Employment and Workplace Relations, Eric Abetz. Welcome to you all. I want to start with the welfare debate, which is in full swing now in the lead up to the budget. Julia Gillard's made it clear there will be some big reforms coming next month. A lot of people often say and question, what does Julia Gillard stand for? Many of the reforms she has on her plate at the moment, from a carbon tax to health reform, the mining tax, are leftovers from the Rudd era. But this is something that Julia Gillard, I guess, wants to put her own stamp on, welfare reform. What are we going to see from the government? All governments want to get more people into work. Tanya Plibersek, are we going to see some real change this time?
Well, obviously, I'm not going to talk about what may or may not be in the budget.
Why not? Come on.
Oh, okay.
But what do you have in mind? Can you give us a sense of why this is going to be any different to what we've heard in the past?
I can tell you in general terms that the Prime Minister is very serious about the fact that with unemployment as low as it is compared with other nations around the world, and with the pressures that are bearing down on us with skills shortages and the need to find workers to support those mining boom areas, that it's going to be very important to match up those jobless people with the job opportunities that are coming in the future. Because if we don't get people working now, those people will be left behind.
The problem is location here, isn't it? Those job opportunities are in the resource projects and far-flung places. The unemployed are in the outer suburbs of the major cities.
Well, there are two problems. There's the geographical problem that you're describing, but there's also a skills matching problem. So we need to, as a government, and we've made steps in this area already, make sure that we're skilling up Australians to do those jobs, and where people are able to move to accept that work that's being offered, we're supporting those people to move.
Giving them a bit of a hand to do so.
So the importance of putting extra investment into making sure that people have the skills that we're going to need as the economy continues to grow, I think, is another very important area that the Prime Minister's spoken about in terms of investment in TAFE and technical colleges, but also in terms of investments and reform in our universities.
Eric Abetz, Tony Abbott's already put some of his ideas on the table, and his ideas are more about tough love, more work for the dole, more welfare quarantining, tighter eligibility rules for the disability support pension, for example. But in the end, it's the same end goal here, isn't it, to get more people into work?
David, we've got a great welfare system in our nation, and I think we should all celebrate that. Unfortunately, a few people use the safety net as a hammock, and I think it behoves any government that is in power at the time to ensure that those that are using the safety net as a hammock, that we wake them up from their slumber.
Is it only a few,
and encourage them?
Because the impression we get from the sort of approach the Coalition's talking about is that this is a significant problem. People bludging on welfare.
If you have one person bludging on welfare, to use your term, David, that is a problem that should be addressed, and I think we can all be agreed that it's a lot more than just one Australian that's doing that at the moment.
But this is the key. How many are? What's the significance of this problem?
I think it is significant to get every Australian that has abilities into work that is matched with their capacities. And unfortunately, at the moment, we have about 800,000 on the disability pension, which is about 220,000 more than the long-term unemployed. And I think there's been a lot of concentration on disabilities as opposed to abilities and matching people's abilities with their capacity to re-enter the workforce. And that is what Tony Abbott was concentrating on. And if I might say, it was great to see Julia Gillard a fortnight later pick up on that same theme and then promote it as her government forward.
I don't want to get into
copycat from us.
This is not the first time she's spoken about these issues, to be fair.
Lee Rhiannon, Do you agree that there is a problem here that needs to be addressed?
Oh, look, clearly we always need to be working to ensure that people are able to find work and that the jobs are there. And as Tanya has identified, that we're looking to improving the skills of our unemployed and the population in general. What we've seen, though, with what came from the Howard government, and it's been repeated now by the opposition leader, Tony Abbott, is a very punitive approach. And I was therefore concerned with some of the language that the Prime Minister used. It sounded as though the Labor government might be looking for a big stick as well.
What particular language?
That she talked about in the way she posed welfare against work. And when you look at the current situation, that there's about 600,000 people on the New Start allowance. Remember, they're living on about $34 a week. They've got to look for $34 a day. And that they have to look for about 10 jobs they've got in a fortnight. If they don't take those jobs, they can be knocked off their benefits for a period of time.
So there's some in a hammock, as Eric Abetz says, who are taking the system for a ride.
If there's a job, Lee, shouldn't they be obliged to take that job if they are able to do it? Why should their fellow Australians continue to subsidise them?
It depends on where the job is and what their skills are. So there's a lot more complexities here. And I would really hope that the government would be working with the ACOS, the Australian Council of Social Services, that have identified that many employers weren't happy previously with how this played out under the Howard government, want more support for employers, and particularly want more skills training. So working in a cooperative way with that sector should be the way to go.
John Hewson, let me bring you in here. When you were Liberal leader, when you were opposition leader, your original fight back plan had some pretty tough measures, such as automatic cancellation of the dole after 9 months. It must sound to you now that these guys are all wimping out on welfare reform.
Pardon me for being sceptical, but I think I've heard all this before over many governments and many budgets. I mean, the objectives have been very similar. The nature of the problem's changed a bit. It's been more intense at some times than it is at others, and I think it was pretty intense in the early 90s. But I'm hearing two conflicting motives here. On the one side, welfare reform means, you know, saving money in welfare, taking benefits off those who don't deserve them and making them, you know, work to get them in some sense. On the other side, you have the very real problem that you've got about 500,000 people in Australia that are long-term unemployed, and it's very difficult, that challenge, to get them back into the workforce. And it's a very expensive process. It's going to cost money rather than save money. A lot of those people have literacy and numeracy difficulties. They have communications difficulties. They haven't fronted an employer in a long time. Mm. And so there's a lot of training and levels of training to bring these people up to speed so they can actually go and get a job. And when you then try and match that with the skill shortages and the geographic nature of that and the nature of the skills themselves, this is a massive problem.
It is a massive problem. And Eric Abetz, does the opposition acknowledge that need for tailored training to get these people into work rather than, I mean, we're talking about carrots and sticks here, rather than the stick of taking welfare away from them?
John Hewson is absolutely right. And when the Howard government introduced its welfare to work proposals, we in fact spent more money in the budget. It was not in fact a savings measure. It was in fact an increase in expenditure to do exactly that, which John Hewson was just speaking about.
Are you proposing that you'd have to do that again? You'd have to spend a fair bit more money to make real change here?
And I think the Australian people would expect us to be able to manage the situation in a way that does ensure that those that are, to use your term, bludging on the welfare system are moved on, but those that are genuinely having difficulty in obtaining employment because they haven't been properly engaged in the past, they don't have a necessary skill level, that they are encouraged and given the tools to which to gain employment.
It sounds like there's a fair bit of common ground here.
I was just wondering whether Eric's going to, you know, switch over to the Labor Party, because the way that I remember
we were the ones that raised the tenure.
The way that I remember some of those Howard reforms, as you call them, Eric, were that they were quite punitive. The 8 week automatic suspension, no questions asked, no excuses accepted, meant that a lot of people who had genuine reasons, including not receiving or not being able to read correspondence that was sent to them, were cut off benefits for 8 weeks, and many of them lost their homes at that time. I do think you need a a finer approach to this, an approach that recognises individual circumstances. And I'm sure that, you know, when the budget is brought down, the Prime Minister's understanding of what's needed in terms of support and training and education, but also encouragement sometimes and a little bit of a push for some people, I think you'll see that balance.
What sort of push are you talking about?
I'm not talking about anything specific because we're not talking about the budget.
David,
but you do acknowledge the need for, as I say, carrot and stick, some sort of push.
What you're really saying here, though, is that this is going to take fairly careful, almost individual case management. And that is a very expensive process. And when you take the holistic approach to that and link the full education and training system to the labour market conditions and so on, that is a very complex issue that requires a lot of detail and a lot of money spent to actually make it happen. But that hasn't happened over successive governments.
Surely the point is that with unemployment as it is now, with all of these opportunities coming at us because of the mining boom, we need to grasp this opportunity with both hands and say that this is our chance to get a whole lot of people who are socially and economically excluded in this country and move them into the workforce so that they can be part of our society and part of our economy
entirely
more fully than they are now.
I agree entirely with that, except that, you know, we start from a bit of a false position as well. We talk about an unemployment rate of 4.9%. There's also a massive underemployment problem on top of that, which means there's a lot of people who are working less than they'd otherwise like to
work. And in these pockets where unemployment is high, it is in double digits, a lot higher than 4.9%. And not many of these people can shift to a resources project in you know, Gorgon, Northwest Shelf or Central Queensland. I mean, single parents, older, unemployed.
A lot of older people.
It's not easy for them to... Yes, you can put them through a training course, but not easy for them to go and fill those vacancies.
There are no simple solutions to this. It's a complex problem that'll take, as I say, a fine-tuned approach.
But there's also that long-term planning from governments that we still see lacking. And I think it'd probably be worth bringing in now, David, Eric's comments on the evening news about the car industry, where we could be about to see a number of people unemployed there.
And this is the Ford job cuts of 240 jobs.
And Eric pushed the blame back onto the current government that they hadn't seen and done the planning in terms of ensuring that we're retaining the bigger vehicles. But what we're seeing is both Labor and the Coalition failing to read people's concerns that prices are rising for petrol and that they're shifting to smaller cars.
This is a slightly separate issue,
Can I quickly say I was not talking about a government plan in relation to Ford. In fact, what I was saying was that when people are under huge cost of living pressures, where job security is no longer what it used to be, they've got a threat of a carbon tax
as
well.
Has there been job security in car manufacturing for a while?
No, hear me out. Generally, within the community, you're right, Tanya, that if you are in that situation, in the market for a new car, with all that uncertainty and huge cost of living pressures, are you going to buy a big, expensive Australian-made car or opt out of an abundance of caution for a small, imported, cheaper car?
So the carbon tax is to blame for these jobs?
No. It is the cost of living pressures, and it's interesting that Ford have indicated that the loss of the car market in this area has occurred basically since Julia Gillard became Prime Minister again over the last 6 months.
Let's get a response from
Tanya. There's two things to say here. There were job losses in the car sector when John Howard was the Prime Minister. I'm sure
and
I'm not the first
to... Who did you blame each and every time the Howard government?
And the second thing I'd say is you're talking about job security. This is from one of the architects of work choices, the single most threatening thing to most people's jobs that we've seen in the decade, it cost you the election.
Unemployment under us was 3.9%. 3.9% unemployment.
With both the policies towards the car industry is that there is going to be uncertainty within that industry. And if we want to have that security and to have that long-term job creation, we do need to have greater investment into fixed rail. That's where we can have that sustainable transport industry, and there can be the creation of jobs, huge boom for rural and regional Australia.
I think people still want to buy cars.
We're not denying that, but they go together.
I can't help but think about what's happened in the American car sector, for example, car industry, where, you know, basically the big players, GM and Ford, got it wrong. They got the technology wrong, they got the marketing wrong, they got the product wrong, and they suffered enormously. And that's come out conspicuously in the last few years. And there are elements of that in all countries in relation to the car industry.
I must say, John, other than Ford, Ford did cut through in the United States because they made some very important changes.
But here, you're saying this is more about Ford than governments.
I think it's more about Ford than governments. Government policies have had an influence. I mean, for decades we've noticed a decline in the car industry as we've gone to a global car manufacturing process rather than a focused local manufacturing process. We've managed to survive on a brain-based competitive edge of supplying to that car-making process. But you know, Ford, for decades in Australia, ran the Falcon as its lead product. I don't think it ever made any money out of it. It never made anywhere else in the world. It was made for this market, focused on this market, and now seen, I think, as you look back on it, as a substantial disaster.
We're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to move to the carbon tax issue. The government's guarantee this week that millions of households will be better off. Stay with us. Welcome back. We're joined this week by the Human Services Minister, Tanya Plibersek, the Greens Senator-elect Lee Rhiannon, the former Liberal leader John Hewson, and the Liberal Senate leader and Shadow Workplace Relations Minister Eric Abetz. I want to move to the carbon tax. This week the government has moved to reframe the debate by focusing on compensation. Greg Combe has guaranteed that more than half the money raised from the tax will go to households, and millions of households, low-income households, he says, will actually be financially better off once all of this is introduced. But Tanya Plibersek, how will they be compensated?
Do you want me to give you the figures, like the budget?
Please do. Yeah. But this is the point, again.
Well, it won't be in the budget.
Like the budget.
There's no detail, is there?
And the reason that we're doing it in this way, giving a broad framework and then filling in the detail as we go, is because this is still a matter of negotiation and discussion with industry and with organisations like ACOS and other community sector organisations. What we wanted to do is show people the broad outline and then talk about, negotiate, discuss and fine-tune the detail. And that's, I think, a much better way of proceeding than releasing a fully formed package that half of Australia is not happy with.
But having given this guarantee this week, you are making some, without a lot of that detail, it is still a pretty significant decision because it now limits what industry can get, what can go to energy efficiency. And it also raises the question of how do you ensure that this guarantee can be maintained. The carbon price is going to rise over the years. Does that mean the compensation will continue rising as well?
Well, Greg Combe said that we'll start with a proportion of compensation above 50% going to households, and we'll keep a proportion above 50% in the years into the future. The details of how much and who will benefit, as I say, are still being negotiated. But if you look at the original CPRS that we almost got agreement from the Liberals on before they rolled Malcolm Turnbull on it, there were some very low...
And year old Kevin Rudd.
There were some very low income households that were getting compensation to the tune of 120 or 125%. Also, people who change their behaviour are better off. So if you get compensated for the amount that that costs rise, but you change your behaviour, you're also potentially better off in that way.
Yeah, if you use less electricity. Lee Rhiannon, the Greens' main concern with Labor will come when it gets to industry compensation. That's the real point of contention between your two parties. But on household compensation, are the Greens comfortable with the guarantee that's been made? And what sort of direction should that household compensation go in? I mean, is tax cuts the answer, or would you rather see it targeted at energy efficiency?
Christine Milne has said that there's actually a much greater degree of agreement than is often presented within the media in terms of how the different parties on the Climate Change Committee are working. Mm. I mean, it's Christine and Bob and Adam Bandt who are our team there, and they're obviously across the detail, and it's not my place to be going into that, and I actually don't know those details. But what is very clear is that we can have the compensation and have extensive energy efficiency measures. Sometimes one's posed against the other, but those measures can go together in a very extensive way. It's just we obviously need to work out at what level, what dollar amount is going to be on, for that carbon tax, and that will help inform
well,
us.
Well, I'll get to that in a minute because that will be a point of contention between your two parties as well, I'm sure. John Hewson, has this been a smart political move from the government this week?
You mentioned my fight-back package, which was tagged as the longest suicide note in political history. I think this is a political suicide strategy to actually announce in principle that you're going to have a price and then not give any detail for several months of legislation, not until September, I think Greg Combo said. I mean, that's giving Tony Abbott and his team the opportunity to kick you to death every day between the time you announce the decision and, of course, when you provide the detail. I think in terms of compensation, I think it does reassure people to a certain extent that there will be compensation targeted at the bottom end to low middle income earners, and that compensation will be maintained into the future. But I think people would have more confidence if the revenue from the carbon tax was being collected by an independent authority and that compensation allocated by an independent authority rather than going into, you know, the government's hands, and because the suspicion will always be, oh, you know, this is fine, they'll start it low and they'll then whip it up and they'll collect the extra money and the money will go somewhere else. That uncertainty is always going to be there. Mm. And it's going to be very hard to dissuade people of the view that, you know, that the government should be trusted with all this revenue, all this new revenue.
Eric Abetz, the Coalition have said if you win the election, you'll get rid of the tax and you'll get rid of the compensation as well. Isn't the reality, therefore, that you could be going to the election saying a lot of low-income families, households, pensioners will be worse off?
David, this whole carbon tax debate that we're having this evening is based on a deceit that Julia Gillard said to the Australian people, under a government I lead, there will be no carbon tax.
I thought you might work that in somehow.
We now know that she is having a carbon tax. Having deceived the Australian people, why on earth should any one of them believe that they are going to be compensated, compensated in a fair way?
Getting back to the question, though, about the prospect that you'll be going to the election saying a lot of low-income, millions of low-income households will actually be worse off.
Well, let's wait and see with what the actual compensation package is, because I think Labor have underestimated. Their own Treasury have told us how much it's going to cost households, and we had Labor coming out condemning their own Treasury costings in relation to the actual costs.
Well, so I don't think they were condemning them. They were saying these are just models. Different prices.
Households will suffer. Every household will suffer. It seems that Labor is now saying we will, and taking up John Hewson's point, we will play favourites. David, we like you, we'll compensate you. Tanya, you're part of a demographic that we don't want to compensate. Lee, is everybody going to be compensated? No. So there will be losers.
There's obviously classifications here.
There will be losers.
But this is the same as any government assistance, though. Family tax benefits, various handouts go on according to income. This is according to income.
The Labor government is trying to assure the electorate in a situation where we don't know the extent of the tax, the level of the tax, let alone how this compensation is going to be provided.
Eric will not answer the question, will you get rid of the compensation? Joe Hockey says you will. Tony Abbott's been here and there on it. Can you give a straight answer on that? Are you going to get rid of the compensation?
The Labor Party asking me for a straight answer in circumstances when you deceived the people of Australia.
No, not a straight answer.
When you deceived the Australian people. about no carbon
tax. That's a legitimate point. That's a legitimate point. But is there an answer on this?
We will have a look.
No, it's not a legitimate point.
We will have a look.
It's not a legitimate point.
She did say there will be no carbon tax.
But Tanya Abetz also said he will have a carbon tax.
Just a moment. Let's get an answer on this.
And when we said, don't trust Labor, there will be a carbon tax. Wayne Swan accused us of being hysterical.
But Eric Abetz, will the compensation
go? We don't know what the tax is or what the compensation is. When we've got the full detail, what we're saying to the Australian people is this: we oppose a carbon tax.
No, you're just saying the same thing. Will the compensation go? Joe Hockey says yes. You're saying now no.
We say that if there's no carbon tax, there is no need for compensation.
So it will go.
And what you're doing is robbing pay Peter, robbing Paul to pay Paul without any real benefit to anybody. It is just churning the money.
Just finally on this, Eric Abetz, has the position changed at all from as Joe Hockey articulated?
No.
Okay, John Hewson.
I was going to say, I'll bet you that if people are being paid compensation in the run-up to the election, you won't be standing up saying, I'm going to take it off you. Yeah. It's a practical matter.
What we'll say is we will be removing the tax which has necessitated this extra compensation.
So we're going to take the compensation.
And the tax, the tax being removed will mean that their cost of living comes down.
You give $300 to a low-income earner and say, I'm taking it back in 2 weeks' time.
Yeah.
Tough. Not going to happen.
Not going to happen.
But back on Julia Gillard's broken promise, it's hard to walk away from that.
Yeah. But what Eric pretends never happened is Julia Gillard saying for years before this that she is committed to introducing a price on carbon. The carbon tax was not...
Please.
Excuse me, that's true. The carbon tax was not our preferred way of introducing it. Our preferred way of introducing it was the carbon pollution reduction scheme that Malcolm Turnbull and almost half of the members of the Liberal Party supported. Unfortunately, we weren't able to get that through the House of Representatives because of the downfall of Malcolm Turnbull, and we weren't able to get through the Senate because of the Greens.
Yeah, but it was a sham system that did not reduce greenhouse gas emissions
because
of the compensation.
Julia Gillard was the one that convinced Kevin Rudd to drop the scheme. We know that. Kevin Rudd has told the Australian people that.
And she then, let's be clear, she then went to the election saying that she would like a carbon price, but only once there's consensus in the community and in business.
And that's why we're building that consensus
now. And she then went a step further in saying there won't be a carbon tax.
And we're building that consensus. She had three positions in that election campaign. She supported an ETS as a way of putting a price on carbon. She supported the Citizens' Assembly to decide whether, in fact, there should be a price put on carbon. And then in the final day, she said there wouldn't be a carbon tax. So she had three positions. She's picked one of them.
But David, talking about broken promises...
You're very generous,
Tony Abbott, and I've only actually ever seen on Sky News once, made that very clear promise, commitment, to a carbon tax. He actually signed off that he supported a carbon tax.
You're talking about what he wrote in the Battle Lines book and in our interview
that I did
with Tony Abbott after that.
He states that
clearly. He did. But
really
we know
clearly.
Tony Abbott's had some different positions over the years.
Tony Abbott went to the last election.
Ms. Gillard and Mr. Abbott have both broken their previous position.
No.
Both of them have had more positions on this than the Kama Sutra.
Nobody.
We have a current debate now. The government has committed to a policy. Let's see how they're going to implement it and what damage it's
going to do. I think we should look at what is going to happen now. There's talk of a $20 a tonne carbon price and various views on whether that's going to be enough to really drive any change in behaviour, any move to renewable energy. It's certainly at the lower end of what Ross Garnaut's recommended and at the, below what most environmentalists say is necessary to make any change in the economy. Lee Rhiannon, what do you think of a $20 carbon price?
Oh, well, I mean, obviously, personally, I would like to see it higher, and Ross Garnaut has got a great deal of expertise in this area. He's the person that the former Labor government brought in to help them work this through. So I would hope that they would take his advice. But again, our team is working in a very cooperative way.
But the point is, you've just bagged the old CPRS saying it was a sham scheme. If this scheme ends up with a $20 a tonne price, that's going to be even worse than the $26 that the CPRS had.
No, the carbon tax is much more targeted and can change behaviour in a much more far-reaching way.
Well, it's It's essentially the same approach, I must say. And one was a $26. If they come up with a $20 and the Greens vote for it, you're voting for something that's weaker than the CPRS.
Well, I'd still argue that the carbon tax is more targeted in terms of how it delivers change within the industry, in terms of that all-important transition that we need to clean renewable energy.
How's it more targeted than the CPRS?
Because of the way, where we lost out with the CPRS is the degree of compensation that was being paid to the big polluters, and the combination with the carbon credits and the whole ridiculous.
You don't reckon this one will have the same compensation?
But
that's what we'll be arguing that case for. Our team will do a good job.
But David, as I understood it, the carbon tax is just a prelude to a full-scale emissions trading scheme.
Yep, to a flexible price. Yeah. John Hewson, what do you think? Is $20 a tonne going to
I think from the government's point of view, it's a question of strategy. Do they just establish a price at a low level with the expectation that once it's in there, people get used to it, and it'll be easier to raise it? Or do they decide that it's going to be pretty difficult, you know, maybe a death of 1,000 cuts? We'll just go for a big hit on day one. We'll go for $40 to start or some number like that, recognising that to increase it in the next couple of years will just be small increments on that number. And this is a question of strategy. I'm sure they're trying to make up their mind which is the best way to go.
What would you do
objectively? I think Ross Garnaut's numbers are broadly right. And I think most people would look at $30 to $40 as a starting price as a minimum. Mm. It's going to go to $60 fairly quickly by most model estimates that I've seen. From the government's point of view, they need to condition people as to what's going to happen and how that's going to flow through. And that is the big argument to come, is when you set a price, what does it mean for electricity prices? What does it mean for petrol, whether petrol's in or out? Whatever is in or out, we don't know. But what does it mean for what is in, and how much impact will have?
I was talking to someone in the aluminium industry today who made the point they make investment decisions on a 10 to 15 year time frame. They need to know not what it's going to be next year, but what that price is going to be in 10 years. The government will have to be upfront about this, won't they? That the starting price isn't what it's going to be in 10 years.
Well, all of those things are being worked through by Greg Combe with industry at the moment, and that's why we've taken this approach. So all of these issues can be discussed.
Right. I think one principle that has to be adhered to, though, is that you should be taking on the big polluters. They've had decades to get ready for this. I saw your interview with the aluminium smelting industry today. I had a debate 5 or 6 years ago with that industry about this. They had admitted that they had been expecting it to come, preparing for it at board level, at management level, strategising. You know, they've known, they've prepared for it. It's already factored in at a level.
And that's one of the key reasons they don't deserve the compensation.
They should not be polluted. They should not be compensated beyond a short transitional period. And I think politically, if you want to gain some ground back, take on the big polluters, like the smokers have been taken on, or those who, you know, in the asbestos industry have been taken on. It's an easy political argument to win. And I would think you can turn this around.
I can hear Lee Rhiannon.
I might even agree
John
with Lee.
John, that's a cheap, it's an easy argument, but it's a cheap one, because these companies will then have to write down their value, the share dividend flow will be less, and anybody that's in a superannuation fund now will be given a double whammy of the super decreasing in value whilst their cost of living goes up. And to say that you can somehow just bash up the big polluters, do you think they're not going to pass it on to their customers, especially the electricity users, those that use aluminium, those that buy zinc, those that buy cement? And these companies have to operate in an international market
We've got to move on from this topic, but I just do want to clear up. Lee Rhiannon, you'll be a senator voting on this, because it won't be put to the Senate until you're in there in the second half of the year. Will you vote for a scheme that offers the same compensation as the CPRS did to industry, which you believe was too much, if the carbon price is even lower than it was under the CPRS?
Look, I'm obviously not there yet. I'll be part of, we've got an excellent party room, be part of the team, and that will
But you'll want to see something that's tougher on industry.
Because we're working for it to be tougher on industry, and that's what Christine Milne, Bob Brown and Adam Band are working hard for. So I'll be part of that party room come July 1, and we'll go forward with a united position. At the moment, I don't know what that is.
But is Labor going to put up something that's tougher on industry than the CPRS?
Well, all of these details are being negotiated at the moment.
A lot of detail to work out. After the break, we're going to move on to some other matters. What are the attitudes towards women in defence? And we'll also be looking at the Greens, the debate over whether they are a mainstream or an extremist party. Stay with us. Welcome back to the program. We're joined this week by the Minister for Human Services, Tanya Plibersek, the Greens Senator-elect Lee Rhiannon, the former Liberal leader, John Hewson, and the Liberal Senate leader and Shadow Minister for Employment and Workplace Relations, Eric Abetz. I want to move to the Minister versus the military issues that we've seen in the last week or two. Six separate inquiries were this week launched by Defence Minister Stephen Smith following the ADFA sex Skype scandal and the Minister's anger over the fact that the young female cadet at the centre of this was called before a disciplinary hearing over a separate matter. Now, while these inquiries are underway, the head of ADFA has been stood aside, Bruce Kafer. The young men, however, who were allegedly involved in filming and watching the sex with this young woman remain at ADFA. Tanya, does that make sense to you?
Well, I'm not going to make too many comments about the specifics of this case, but I think it's clear that there is a cultural issue in defence that defence itself, the head of defence, Angus Houston, has also acknowledged and wants to get to the bottom of. I'm not going to comment on what should happen to those young men.
Mm-hmm. But it seems to be a somewhat contradictory position where Commandant Kafer is stood aside while the inquiries are underway, but these young men are not.
Well, I think there were two issues. There's the actual issue of the broadcasting of the sex act, and there doesn't seem to be much contradiction that that actually happened. And
well, in that case, shouldn't they be suspended or kicked out?
I'm not going to comment on what's happened to those kids, but I think that there is, talking about the issue, there is a clear moral, if not legal, culpability involved there, and it's proper that the police are investigating to see whether there's also some legal culpability. Mm. But that hasn't happened yet. There is a police investigation ongoing.
Is anyone else uncomfortable with this situation where Bruce Kafer's been stood aside and the young men have not?
Yes, I was.
Let's just hear, Lee Rhiannon, you think what the...
I don't think they should have been thrown out of the institution and they lose the career that they've obviously chosen. But clearly we need a cultural change here and you can't just allow things to go on as though we really haven't had... The problem's not so serious. I did find it quite refreshing how the minister's handled it. I thought he's been very frank. These issues are often difficult. I did notice that one comment was comparing what's happening in the military to often what's happening sometimes in football clubs. Mm. And they were, some of the military weren't too pleased with that comparison. But I think it does help identify the cultural problem that we have. In many ways, there is a similarity. Australians very much love their football heroes, the military. People feel very proud of them. And it's a very male institution. And when things go wrong, we clearly don't have the means to be able to handle these situations. So something has to give.
Yeah, there are big differences as well, though. I mean, in football, you've got a lot of money and fame, and in defence, you know, you've got some different issues there. But Eric Abetz, what do you think about this decision to stand aside Bruce Kafer?
Can I say, first of all, that the men and women that serve in our defence forces are great men and women who deserve the admiration of the Australian people. What we have seen in recent times is a revelation that I think would shock all Australians, clearly behaviour that should not be condoned. Above and beyond that, with police inquiries going on, six departmental inquiries going on, etc., I think it ill behaves us to jump to too many conclusions about a commandant or particular young men without the full inquiry.
So he should not have been stood aside.
I'm not going to comment on that, and after all the inquiries, we will ascertain as to what actions should have been, could have been taken in the circumstances.
You seem to be saying there's too many inquiries underway. What don't you think?
No. I'm not saying that. Let all the inquiries run their course. That is why you have inquiries. Mm. But with respect, there's been a lengthy inquiry currently being undertaken by Defence as to the role of women at the front line. In the midst of all this, the Minister has come out saying women will now be in the front line. You wonder why we've had this inquiry going on, I think, now for some 2 years.
So you're saying this is a diversion.
So if we're going to have these inquiries, they should actually...
Enough,
well, you are the government. You can curtail these inquiries and make them come to a conclusion. You've been in government now for all that time.
We'll get to the issue of women on the front line, but John Hewson.
Look, I don't want to get into the detail because it's not for us to judge. Mm. I don't like the perception of double standard in your question. I just take a bigger point. I just think that and I strongly support the attempts of Steve Smith as minister to make a stand, in a sense, against the military. For too long, in my view, the military has been ring-fenced. Mm. They've been left to do their own inquiries into their own misdemeanours and bad behaviour and so on. When I think that the public today would expect that there'd be full independent inquiries of what's happened in the military. And if it's a police matter, it's a police inquiry, not a military inquiry. We're getting more to that with the sort of inquiries that have been announced. You know, unfortunately, defence ministers that have made a stand against the military have ended up packing their bags fairly quickly.
This is another fascinating part of this. Various reports about the tension and hostility between the minister and the top brass. Do you think Stephen Smith is taking a tougher line?
I think he is. And I just go back to when Steve Smith was appointed as the Minister for Defence. I remember a press conference called by Angus Houston commenting on the new minister. And for Christ's sake, he works for the minister under our system of government. And they've had this attitude for far too long. They get away with far too much. In any other circumstances in Australia, football clubs or anywhere else, you would be having independent police inquiries, judicial inquiries, whatever. Mm. And I think that's time that Smith makes that stand.
It is different to any other department, though. These are people asked to put their lives on the line.
But you've got the military, you've got the department, you've got the minister. The minister runs the show and calls the shots. Mm. Mm. And he should be seen to be doing that by everybody in that process, whether they're departmental people or military people. And I'm just staggered that we've let this go for so long. And you can go to the budget. Mm. I mean, they've been ring-fenced. They haven't had the expenditure scrutiny that other departments of government have had. Your area here, Human Services, what do you say, 40% of government, 40,000 employees and very substantial percentage of government. It's constantly scrutinised, you know, for every dollar, if you like. The military's not.
A project falls over and suddenly, $10 billion
That hits the headlines pretty quickly, yeah.
But I think I'd take issue with one thing that John said, and that is characterising this as a fight between the minister and Angus Houston, or the chief, or the head of the military. It seems to me that Angus Houston is as committed to making the military a good culture for the young men and women who are entering the military, and for keeping those people engaged as serving Army, Air Force, or Navy. Throughout their career, he himself has initiated a lot of these changes. Well, using him as the figurehead of the top of the military, he has initiated, or they as a group have initiated, a lot of this change themselves in the last few years. They understand that they've got a problem in attracting and retaining women. Mm. They want to attract and retain women because they've got a problem attracting and retaining service personnel.
So it's part of it giving women more active roles, SAS, Navy clearance, diving, some of these roles that they currently can't perform.
Look, almost 100% of military roles are already open to women.
93%.
We already have women serving on the front line. They're serving in a range of different jobs on the front line. What we're talking about now are the few very dangerous, very demanding jobs, and the issue is, should they be barred from serving on the basis of gender, or should we be saying, are people physically capable, intellectually, emotionally, psychologically capable of doing this work? If they are, why would we deny them the right to serve their country?
Hard to argue that, isn't it?
Absolutely.
I agree.
But also the change that's needed is also in leadership, is more women coming through in leadership in key areas of the military.
And they won't be high-ranking leaders unless they're able to do all of these jobs. That is part of the stream of promotion.
The chicken and egg. Yeah. A final issue I want to cover tonight. A lot of commentary since the New South Wales election about the Greens and whether the party is really a mainstream party, as Bob Brown suggests, or an extremist party, as Julia Gillard has suggested. Much of the focus has been on the decision by the New South Wales Greens to support a boycott and sanctions against Israel. Now, Bob Brown has distanced himself from that policy, and Lee Rhiannon, I think he's you know, criticised the approach that the New South Wales Greens took during the election campaign. For the record, do you still support a boycott and sanctions against Israel?
Oh, look, I certainly wouldn't shy away from advocating for human rights, including human rights for Palestinians. I mean, Bob is our foreign affairs spokesperson. This isn't something that's going into the federal parliament. But there is a long history within Australia that within different communities, different levels of government, we've seen it with local government going back to the 1970s, the Wollongong local
Back to the question, do you support a boycott against Israel?
Yes, yeah, that is what the New South Wales has a proposal for that, and
My own position is
that it's not an anti-Israel position at all. It is about a boycott to bring forward policies that will work for Palestinians, because at the moment Palestinians just don't have a lot of the human rights we take for granted. Mm. They can't move easily around their country. There's not equity in jobs and education. They can't be confident their houses are going to be blown up.
I'm just confused, though, in your position, as someone who's about to come into the Senate, as a Green senator, do you support a boycott or sanctions against Israel?
I've just answered that question. I've said that, yes, we have that position in New South Wales, and I support the New South Wales position. But that's not something we're taking into the federal parliament. They are clear priority.
So, sorry, you'll be a senator with that as a position or not?
Yeah, so there's a whole range. The New South Wales, as does the Australian Greens, we have policies on a whole range of things. Mm. But in terms of what our priorities are, our clear priority is addressing climate change. One passion that I have is about protecting farming land from mining.
Yeah, but this is the issue that's got you into some hot water. You're saying you're not anti-Israel.
Yes.
But you want a boycott and impose sanctions on Israel.
But let's remember, this is a global movement. It's a global movement that's growing.
What's the global movement?
The global movement around boycotting for Palestinians. So that it's not something that just the Greens are working on.
It's anti-Israel.
It's not anti-Israel at all. There's actually many Jewish communities that support this work, and it is much broader. How it's been presented...
But isn't a boycott or sanctions going to damage Israel? That's the point of it.
It's targeting Israeli policies, but it's also about raising...
And their economy. I mean, it's about trade, it's about hurting Israel. It's anti-Israel.
It's not anti-Israel at all.
But it's designed to hurt Israel.
But there's a large number...
If that's not anti-Israel, I'd like to know what is.
It's pro-Palestinian people, because of the extreme conditions under which many of them live. It's worth remembering that the...
But pro-Palestinian, I just know why you can't say that it's anti-Israel if it's designed to hurt Israel financially.
But it's not anti-Israel, because if we could resolve the situation in terms of how the Palestinians live, this would be best in terms of peace in the Middle East.
Do you support a two-state solution?
Yes.
With a Jewish state alongside a Palestinian state?
Okay. Yes.
You can be pro-Palestinian without being anti-Israel, as the Greens
we are not anti-Israel,
portraying
Eric.
This. And if the New South Wales Greens are so committed to human rights, and I welcome that, one wonders, why not a trade boycott on Cuba, North Korea? Why haven't those two countries come to front of mind as opposed to Israel? You know, I think the Australian public...
Let's get an answer on that.
Eric, I'm aware that many people rattle off a whole number of countries. Mm. The difference here, and there is similarities to how the movement developed around South Africa and the ending the apartheid regime, because there was a big international boycott movement there, with regard to the Palestine situation, is that the majority of civil society in Palestine have made this request. And across Europe, there are many universities, unions and community groups that support
this. We're nearly out of time. I want to get a quick couple of comments.
Is this about the blockade of Gaza?
Well, part of that, and that's
because,
something...
Because doesn't Egypt also blockade Gaza on the other side? Why haven't you saw trade sanctions against Egypt Why only single out Israel?
I think you're aware of the changes that have occurred in Egypt. But let's remember, a lot of why this has been highlighted by News Limited is to attack and misrepresent the Greens.
Well, it's scrutiny of the Greens is what it's about. You're trying to be a mainstream party. Major parties have to go through.
I just say two quick things. You're going to have a very interesting time in Canberra, in that party room, that Green party room. Secondly, are the Greens a mainstream party, the question you asked first? I don't think so. I think they're largely all care and very little responsibility. And they raise the stakes on issues where they know they'll never be in government and have to implement that that position. And so I think it does taint
the whole agreement.
Tanya Plibersek, a final question to you. Do you agree with your leader that they're a bunch of extremists?
Well, I was going to say they are going to implement it, that they're going to have the responsibility on Marrickville Council. They're going to cost their ratepayers $4.5 million to do it.
That's not true. I mean,
your Labor councillors voted for that policy.
And that's a misrepresentation. The whole basis of this movement is it adapts to local situations. That report and the front page story in The Telegraph with misrepresentation. There's no intention to cost the people of Marrickville all that money.
What's the point of that?
I think Marrickville Council should worry about potholes and schools.
I fully agree.
Residents of Marrickville.
Very wise council.
There's a long history.
On that point, we're going to have to wrap things up, I'm afraid. But look, thank you all. Tanya Plibersek, Lee Rhiannon, John Hewson, Eric Abetz. Thank you all for joining us this week. We'll be back next week. Hope you can join us then.
Thank you.